Hello. Jay alerted me today that you'd be absent, and Todd is in Patagonia. So we're running on 5/7, soon to be 4/7, because I'll be going at 5. Marilyn can take over. But I think we can get a lot done. You just blasted past public comment, and Terry says that because of the snowstorms, there are no minutes this week, so we're caught up.
Okay. Moving right along.
All right. I just want to see if I can get in. I'm online. Otherwise, I might need your hotspot, Rich. Okay. I think I'm going to need it. Okay, everybody, let's see, chair report. Rich and I successfully got a meeting with the mayor. It's going to be on something like March 1st.
March 1st, yeah.
Yep.
At
1:30, which is right before the next meeting that we will have. So I'll be able to report on that. So that's good. I also went, that last minute email I sent out to you all, the presentation by Henry Lappin at Nerd Night.
Uh-huh.
I went to it and it was really great. Yeah, he has a really interesting little, 20-minute dog and pony show on the, mysterious and exciting hidden life of trees. And he makes it very interactive and fun. And I think we should consider, he likes giving the talk to, and I think we should consider with him doing it in front of kids, Northampton kids, because I think he would engage them in an interesting way. So he did a nice shout out for us too. And I got a chance to stand up in front of 40 people and talk a little bit about the public shade tree program here in Northampton. So that was good. All right, that's it for my chair report.
I don't really have a report. Other than it snowed a lot, I'm really behind.
Yeah.
And we're doing a bunch of tree work before it's snowing, so I don't really have anything new other than working on reviewing site plan review for a service net parcel at Village Hill. So when you come up 366. I'm about to turn into Village on Village Hill Road. There's the Fazio and Associates buildings on the corner. Right next to that building on the right-hand side, there used to be a bunch of residences there that are no longer there. That whole parcel is going to be developed. Mm-hmm. So there are, I think, about 20 so trees that need to be removed that are trees that fall under significant tree ordinance. So I'm reviewing that in the process of reviewing that. I had a meeting the other day, but unfortunately with Carolyn Mission and David Follett, I couldn't attend because it was snowing and we were all plowing. So, but I have the site plans and I'm going to go and send my comments. Other than that, no public shade tree hearing. Although we did have one resident from Park Hill Road, actually, we sent her information for public shade tree hearing because she wants us to do what they call a vista removal. She wants to have the view of Mount Tom restored, which she had when she first bought their house, and so it's going to require cutting down two mature oaks across the street, which are city trees.
Where is this?
Well, we haven't seen the request yet, have we?
Has something like that ever come across your? That's
no.
Wow. That's a very.
What's the protocol for dealing with that?
I think it falls under MGL 87, just like anything else.
The answer is no.
Yeah.
Oh, you can't just cut trees for vista.
No.
Especially if they're city trees.
No. No, I'm not going to start doing that because people don't want to hurt it now.
I know. Yeah.
I can't see my street sign for us. No. Obviously, the lady, unfortunately, I think she called last year. I don't really know the whole, you know the story because you dealt with her more than I did.
She called last year. Inquiring if they were city trees, and then we determined that they were city trees, and then at that time she didn't specify what she wanted done with the trees if they were city trees. So at that point we determined they were city trees, and then it was never looked at again until she called back and said, well, I had a work order and are you going to come cut them down? I said, no, that's not how it works. So I explained the process and I said, okay, work out and let me show.
vista removal. Vista prune, I guess you would say, we've done, you know, sightline, but not really for like the visual, like Montgomery.
Yeah. Okay, good.
So that's really the only thing that's in the pipe. Plus, we're just plugging away at doing tree removal in regards to just plugging away one at a time with the tree inventory.
Have you had any chance to evaluate whether your view of the trees and the Davy trees are similar, or are you finding some of them not such big?
Are you talking about the plan?
Yeah.
With regard to the plan? Okay,
yeah.
Can we hold that off until the top
time
of the plan?
Yeah, sure. I can talk about that when we talk about the actual plan. Because I think we'll get a half an hour for it.
Yeah.
I can make my comments then.
About removal?
Yes, yeah. Yes. That's it.
Okay, that's it. All right, so that's great. That gives us more time to talk about the plan. And I thought, I just want to make a general comment that if people can bring their laptops to these meetings, it's helpful. Because, for example, with regard to this Google Sheet, it's all right here, and then we can be looking at the comments while we... So if you're able to, it would be helpful if you could bring that.
I brought my laptop a couple times and didn't get online. Are we really certain that you can get online?
Well, he's got a hotspot. I did get online from the city site, but
yeah.
In the backup plan is his hotspot.
Okay.
Yeah. So thank you all for making comments in the Google Sheet. I want to make sure that Terry, this becomes a public record, mm-hmm. so that there's no question of transparency issues. So. When this is fully populated, Jay and Todd and Rich, I would actually love for you to record your comments here too. So when Jay and Todd and Rich do them, then I would go ahead and make them part of the public record. You know, so like at one of the next meetings, we would, I guess, accept it as part of the minutes.
Okay.
I just don't want there to be any sense of like that we're doing backdoor stuff.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Totally.
Okay. All right, so what I thought I would do, especially now since we have extra time, is first have us just go around and let everyone speak without interruption, without comment back about their impression of the plan and some thoughts questions that bubble out of it. And then we can kind of go into a back and forth conversation, and maybe we can make sure that we have covered all the comments that people have put on the document. How does that
suggesting that we might clean up the same things that we put on the document in every iteration?
You can do that. Yeah, I mean, you can use, we could say everyone has like 3 minutes and you can just use it however you want. Do you have yours there? Because
I did put them in there. And so what you're saying is even if I put them there, I might sit and, you know, is that done?
And you could do it however you want.
And if you want to come here and sit while I'm meet yours, right. I have it up.
Yeah. Okay, we can start with you, Bob, if you want.
Okay, well, I did put my comments online, so I think probably most of you have seen it. I guess just to illustrate, I'll just ask Rich a question.
Yes, sir.
So Hinckley Street, this gets really specific, but on a lot of streets, there's no sidewalk on one side, and that's a very good potential place to plant trees. But Todd Ford pointed out that might be exactly where there might be a sidewalk. So do you know on Hinckley Street, which is being rebuilt, whether there's a sidewalk or not a sidewalk?
There is going to be a sidewalk on one side. From what I
on one side, so on the other side.
I think so. Don't quote me on that because I have not been in the... That project has been in design five or 6 years.
It might seem really specific, but in terms of large tree opportunities, that's where a lot of the large tree opportunities are. And so it's kind of relevant. I guess that's the other big concept I wanted to make sure we got out within my 3 minutes is that it is possible using the My Tree Keeper to look at specific neighborhoods rather than the whole city. And so 17% of the trees are in tree belts. And those trees are in relatively urban areas near sidewalks, as opposed to maybe out along, I don't know, Ryan Road or somewhere where there might be a forest. They might have picked up a whole string of sugar maples there. And they have, in fact. And it brings up the question of whether the surrounding forest should be the how, to what degree we should allow the diversity of the population of the forest around the city influence more urban core in terms of tree selection and diversity. So if you have a zillion oaks or maples way out there, does that mean you stop planting them near the downtown? So it just means that you have to go over these statistics a lot finer tone, and also age diversity. So if you find that, yes, there are a lot of really old, say, maple trees, but no young ones, does that mean you don't plant any young ones? Is that diverse? That's pretty much, I guess my overall point is that you need to look at the numbers carefully, but they don't reveal right off the bat. I'd also like to say things have gone pretty well looking at the report. I don't think the sky is falling. I think that we've not planted quite enough trees, not taken down quite enough trees, but overall, it's, you know, doesn't look so bad. Mm-hmm. And yes, I think tree Northampton or can probably prune the young trees. That's it. Thanks.
Great. Can you make that comment about the 17% again? What 70% of the trees?
70% of the surveyed trees are in tree belts. So it just means if you look at the overall, a lot of the trees are not being in tree belts, presumably in parks, along rural roads.
Okay.
You know,
okay. Yep.
And so there's two worlds.
Yep. Yep. Got it.
You got to break that.
So that's not a lot.
Yeah, it's not a lot.
Great. Jen, do you want to go next?
Sure.
You want to go?
Thank you. Oh, I think, I guess just my biggest questions are, whole picture reasonable and doable, you know, like the 5 year, I don't, you know, I haven't done tree management on this scale, so I don't have a feel for, oh yeah, we can do this in 5 years, or, you know. I mean, I was pretty hopeful with the diversity of species. I thought that was pretty good. I mean, we're not doing too bad. And even age, I mean, there's some issues, but we're not, you know, we're not in really bad shape. My biggest concern was about the percentage of spots that were required small trees. And I don't know if those spots were, I mean, if you have overhead wires, that's one thing. But we have a lot of tree belts that are very narrow. And is, you know, almost too narrow really to sustain long-term tree growth. You know, we can put trees in there, but then they live for 7 years or 14 years. Like, do we want to do that? Or there is, you know, if say there's a tree belt sidewalk and then somebody's lawn, there is evidence that you can, let's say we decide to plant a tree here, you could pull up like two sidewalk pads, take that soil out, put in structure soil, and it will serve as like a tunnel. Like the trees will use that as a tunnel, the roots will stay deep and then fan out into the you know, the lawn, adjacent lawn or the adjacent park or something like that. Mm-hmm. So that's rather complicated, but I would like us to try to figure out how to make rooting volume larger for trees. And so that was one of my biggest thing, and I don't have the, you know, I don't have the answer to that, because it just felt like there was a high percentage of trees that were, I mean, we're gonna plant all these small trees. And as far as like shade and, you know, amelioration and a lot of other issues, it's not really that helpful. And then I just had just nuts and bolts questions about, you know, Rich's feeling of how doable this program is, and, you know, whether we need to extend it out, and costs and stuff like that, and what our role is in that. But then also just the nuts and bolts of how to track the 10, 20, 30 rule. Like, how does, just nuts and bolts, how does that work? Like how, what's an efficient way of, when we buy new trees, like how do we track that? I know once we get it on Tree Keeper, we can track that, you know? But, or once we put them in, you can put them in, but like how do we do that? You know, how do we use that information to, in our purchasing and long-term planning, and then how do you mesh that with the types of sites we have? You know what I'm trying to say? Like, how do we do that? So, I think that was it.
Well, overall, the handful of points I want to make is I am really grateful that we were able to do this because it's such useful information. You know, there was some mention about how, you know, other communities don't have this done. So even though the task feels kind of daunting in terms of how we're going to staff and finance it, it's just, it's so valuable. So I'm glad that we have this as, you know, sort of our baseline from which to manage and grow. You know, even the most urgent needs, you know, 909 trees to be removed and 59 high-risk trees that need to be pruned. I mean, even that, I'm wondering, you know, how do we respond? But then, of course, there's, you know, thousands of trees that need pruning on a regular basis. So I did suggest that perhaps this is a good place for Tree Northampton to get involved. One thing I mentioned is I would have liked to have seen more discussion and mention of climate change and extreme weather events. And just as a visual emphasis,
I don't think that's a smart word.
Okay. There were a few places in the report that talked about the economic, the social, and the environmental issues, and this is often how it's displayed, like they're on equal par. But the way I have understood it is, you know, the economy is nested within society, which is nested within the environment or the natural world. So, you know, the economy is often like such this dominant force. There was this great cartoon I saw recently where somebody's talking about climate change and the whole audience is snoozing because they say climate change is threatening existence. And then as soon as he changed the wording to climate change is threatening the economy, everybody woke up. So, but I do feel like, I mean, climate change is bearing down on us, and of course it's going to have a social impact and an economic impact, but we've got to sort of, I don't know, manage from the bigger system. And so I often just feel like climate change needs to be more emphasized in these matters. What else did I say? Oh, the other thing I really want to emphasize, I mentioned this in the last meeting because I had just finished reading that book that came out recently called The Hidden Life of Trees from this German forester. And he really talks about how, you know, just like people, it's not good to be isolated. And trees, like the most healthy systems, forests as well as wooded systems, are those that are well connected, you know, underground through their root system. So as we make this great effort to both plant trees and then do all this pruning that's so highly recommended in this, I just want to emphasize if there's any ways in places where we can plant cluster trees, even a few, so that their root systems are integrated and they're going to be more resilient and robust. And of course, trees that are growing up next to one another, you know, they're not going to just splay out and be and need as much pruning, you know, that they're gonna more naturally shoot up. So I feel like in the long run, it saves time and money and effort. So guess those are my main points.
Great, thank you.
Let's see, well, overlapping with some of what you all have already said. My first impression was, wow, it's really detailed and thorough, this plan, but what a lot of work it is and what a lot of money. And wondering how we're gonna pull that off, both in terms of money and just the time that it takes, and if it's even possible for one person like Rich to oversee this entire project. It looked like to me like the budget numbers, well, the budget didn't have any line items that included additional inspections or like keeping track of new trees that are planted. There was some other thing. Did I say it wasn't included in the budget? That was it. Just planning and tracking the actions on individual trees. Like, it's one thing to go out and just, you know, say, okay, we have to cut 10 trees and here's the cost per tree, but does that cost include the actual planning of actually, you know, which trees are we gonna cut today, which ones are our priorities, and then keeping track of where each individual tree is at, including the young ones that are planted that might die the next year. You know, I guess you have to do annual inspections on all of those individual trees. I don't know if that's included in the budget, if it's built into the per tree cost or not. Let's see, about the climate change, I was thinking about that too, and thinking they have us, right now I think we're in zone 5B, but or just on the edge of 5B and 6A. And the trees they picked out in their list were 6A, you know, is that appropriate, or should we be picking trees for 6B? Or on the other hand, I was thinking, well, we don't know for sure if we're gonna go through a cooling period before we hit the warming period. So then what do you do in that term? I don't know, about the possibility of that, but I mentioned it in the sheet there. So how do you plan, which trees to plant given that crazy up and down possibility? Let's see, I also was interested in the part about the invasive insects. Mm-hmm. And some of the insects they mentioned, like the granulate ambrosia beetle, as far as I know, maybe you know more about this, people are arborists here, but when I did a little bit of, I'd never heard of it, so I looked it up on the internet, and it looks like the closest states, it's mostly a southern species, and the closest states that it's reported are Ohio, Indiana, and Missouri. So it doesn't seem like it's anything that's really immediately applicable to us. Of course, we should look out for it, but it's not anywhere in the Northeast at all. And there's several other ones that sound like similar kind of things. They're southern species. So it seems like they're pretty long-term issues, though you never know. And of the diseases and insects that we do have around here, I'm wondering if it makes sense to have a rapid response plan in place before we actually find them, so that we know what to do, you know, right from the get-go if we do find emerald ash borer or Asian longhorn beetle or, adelgid is already here, but what is our plan? If we find these things, then what? Is there anything we can even do anyway besides just remove those individual trees? So maybe we need some advanced thinking about that. Let's see, what else did I say? Oh, I talked to Ken Gooch from the DCR, and he said that, I asked him where the most recent, I brought this map of where the emerald ash borer is now, and the, I added on the 2016 sightings, which were these green ones here in Wilbraham and Longmeadow are the most, those are the only ones in the valley. There might be other ones throughout the state, but in the valley, those are the two new ones. So I was doubting if the 66, they mentioned 66 inventoried ash trees, so show possible signs of emerald ash borer. That seems really unlikely that there'd be 66, since there's none anywhere around anywhere. I would want to inspect those trees, obviously, and whatever you have to do to find out if it actually is emerald ash borer or not, but it seems unlikely. Not that it couldn't arrive, you know, next week. But again, what do we do if we do find that it is here? And I was wondering if we have any of those, are any of those ash borer traps in Northampton? Those purple ones, yeah.
No.
Yeah. They're mostly out in the hill towns, I think, or in the rural areas.
91, I've seen. Mm. Who does those MDA on?
Yes, I think so.
Yeah, yeah. But it's all grant funded, so what happens at the emerald ash borer, because in Massachusetts, had individual quarantines by the county, what ended up happening is that once it went statewide, there was no more funding available for the traps. And there was actually no reason to have the traps in the counties to actually track the progress of it, because now it's statewide.
As far as embargoes on wood trade go?
Yes.
Yeah.
Sorry, I know I'm not supposed to answer any questions. I just broke the rules.
Oh. All right. Let me see if there's any other little things. I didn't find, where did the number 404 come from for plantings per year? Was that in there somewhere?
It's really the number of sites that they created divided by, multiplied by five, you get the number of potential sites.
I see.
That's really all that number is.
Oh.
And you would actually have to add another 1,000 to that if you consider that they're suggesting that we remove 1,000 trees.
Right.
So it's really.
And also that what.
But anyway, I'm answering your question.
Whoa.
All right, let's keep on.
All right,
if you have any more comments, we'll take those and then we'll just keep on doing this. And then we'll get to a full, robust back and forth.
Okay, done.
Okay, all right. So I'll go, and then Rich, I also want you to have a chance to speak. I would like to ask to have twice the amount of time, because I actually interviewed Molly Freilicher this morning, maybe? No, yesterday morning, and got some of her impressions and put them down here. So I'd like an opportunity to share hers as well. Okay, so first of all, I'd just like to say that thank you all for reading the plan so carefully and bringing your really astute observations and thoughts into it. I agree with pretty much everything I've heard. I too am pretty daunted by the timeline. I think it's completely unrealistic, and I have some data to back that up. But I think that it certainly is a fine starting point, as long as no one holds us to that timeline, because it's completely ridiculous. I like the idea, I've heard it now two or three times, of Tree Northampton potentially taking on the young tree training part of this. That would be really helpful and exciting and a great way to engage citizens. I think as soon as possible, we need to reevaluate all of the high risk trees, and I know that that's high on Rich's list, and then come up with a very aggressive plan for addressing the trees that actually do need to be removed. That seems to be like a point of liability for us that we don't want to be in for very long. So I'll be interested to see us quickly move to that, to a timeline for that. Let's see, what do I have here? I think that this plan will be nicely matched with either LIDAR or iTree has a good canopy view of the whole city, because it does a great job of doing numbers but not of, you know, size of canopy, and that's a really important complement to this. So when we're thinking about like our priority locations, I think that we've got to use both of those things to determine where we want to plant. I mean, I put a ton of things down here. I just had a bunch of questions going in my head. You know, anywhere from, you know, they recommended that we stock our right-of-ways at 90%. How do we prioritize that? Do we want to focus on like sites that have large, that can accommodate large trees? You know, easily accommodate large trees, and then get the most bang for our buck. Like, we'd be providing maximum shade because they're potentially maximum size trees. So just the whole prioritizing locations, I think, is going to be an interesting question. And I have more on that when I talk about what my conversation with Molly. So, you know, I've got more things here. Welcome to look at the questions I put on the document. But I'm going to switch now to my conversation with Molly. And hold on a second. She agreed that there was a very aggressive removal plan here that seemed unrealistic. Struggling with this document. She wanted to remind us that the 10-20-30 rule is not a data-driven rule. It's not research-based at all, and so we should not be held by it. She is more, a case in point is if you go by that rule and you have something like the Asian longhorn beetle come through, it's going to, you know, go through, it could go through 30% of your population if you adhere to that rule. So she is much more in favor of the 5% genus rule, which is challenging, but you know, she of the two, she finds that it's at least a little bit more data-driven.
You're referring to 5, 10, 15?
Well, I think they call it the 5%, which is just no genus, you should have no more than 5% of any genus represented. In other words,
it was presented in some paper we all looked at, it was 5, 10, 15, so 10,
it would be 5, 10, 15.
So that would be species, genus.
Well, it's
no,
a different...
It's a different thing. Rick Harper introduced it when we were at the Tree City USA, or it was a, I don't know, Tree Ward Association, but it's the idea that you don't want any one genus to be represented more than 5%.
Genus.
You know, yeah, you can, I mean, then when you go down to species and so and cultivars, it's kind of immaterial. The important thing is...
Is Rick Harper?
He introduced it to us, but I don't know if it's his concept. Yeah. I feel like we've talked about it in a previous meeting, but anyway.
Yeah, there was some literature we read.
Another thing that Molly said was that she felt the DBH distribution graph really needed to be looked at at a finer grain. Because it goes small or young, maturing, matured, or whatever. There might be four categories, but the young captures trees that are 2 to 8 inch diameter, and she felt that that was just a really broad range.
Yeah,
you know, it doesn't tell you a lot about the youth of your trees. Like you can have 95% of those could be 2 inch trees that are at high risk of mortality. You know, that are just much more vulnerable. Whereas an 8 inch tree is an established tree. She said it's typical when we're triaging here, it's typical for communities to deprioritize stump removal of all the things we can be doing. She felt like, you know, that's one that we could put lower on our bucket list. She suggested, and I have a date with her, to learn how to use iTree Landscape, which allows you to overlay demographic material on a canopy zone. So for example, if we want to think about where we want to prioritize and we want to get like density of population or income level of population, we can overlay that on top of the iTree and identify areas, for example, that might be both devoid of trees and low income, or devoid of trees and high density. You know, these are some things that we intuitively know already, but we might find some interesting material because there's a whole bunch of census material that you can pull up from here. So I've got an appointment to sit with her because Todd and I had talked about wanting to put some real thought into prioritizing locations of plantings, and that's one way to go about it. All right, so the other thing that Molly did for me, and if you can get on this and you can go to sheet 2, if you, you know, this is the spreadsheet, I created a second sheet here, is that I just had her share with me some data of other communities and how, you know, what their stats were in 2016 for planting, pruning, and removing. And to just give an example, Boston, which is 23 times the population size of Northampton.
Sorry.
It's okay. Okay, they pruned 1,650 trees Davey is recommending that in year one, we prune 2,000 trees. Okay, so that's just give you an example. They removed 800, Davies is recommending that we remove 500. They planted 1,400, Davies is recommending that we plant 400. So that's a little bit of like the larger scale. And then I have a whole bunch of other communities nearby us that are comparable in size. For example, West Springfield, last year they planted 312 trees, so that's encouraging that a community our size could plant that many trees.
West Springfield or West Springfield?
West Springfield. West Springfield. And just to give some context, they were awarded a DCR tree planting grant, which we would very much qualify to be awarded. So that's a consideration. So they were able to stretch to a number that we would hope to stretch to. And then trees pruned, we actually did better in terms of pruning trees than most communities comparable to us. And then removing trees, we're kind of on the low end of removing trees, but we could certainly, we know that there are high risk trees that we have to prioritize. So, when I look at this, it just tells me that the Davey timeline is absurd. And that we've got to, I don't know how that we can't stretch it to 10 years. Especially when it comes to, a pruning cycle and removals.
That's very, thank you for doing that.
Sure.
That's kind of amazing.
Well, if it were stretched to 10 years, it wouldn't be that far out of keeping with some of the years that DPW has already done in terms of renewals.
Yep. Okay, so that's my piece. Thank you.
You brought up something, Lily, that I forgot to mention too, which was the emphasis on the younger trees. I don't have any readily available data to back that up, but it just seemed concerning that there was a big emphasis on young and not enough on the mature.
Emphasis on pruning? Emphasis on...
You mean on caring for them or on planting versus caring for the older trees?
Just in terms of what we currently have, it seemed like there was an emphasis on having more young than mature.
Okay.
Like on page 5.
Yeah. Okay.
Page 6.
All right. We can talk about that. I just want to make sure that Rich gets his chance, and then we'll open up the conversation.
That's why I went home and took a nap today.
Yeah.
I don't know if it did me any good. I don't know. I have a lot of... I guess for me, one of the things... I guess this is very broad-based. This is a very large picture. I have a tendency, because of the nature of operations, what I do is I focus on pieces of it. And so one of the most important pieces Lily touched upon is evaluating and determining the high-risk removals that Davey has said that need to be removed, which I don't necessarily completely agree with, just based on some preliminary work that I've done in the field. However, there are some trees that Davey has brought to our attention that are definitely need to be removed. So it's going to be taken on a case-by-case basis. I think one of the most important things, for me anyways, is that this document is extremely important, but the software piece that goes with this document that actually is a lot that basically houses our inventory information is very important for me to master.
Yeah.
Because we can say whatever we like and decide a course, but if we don't have the ability to actually keep track and accurate records of everything, then we're going to be in trouble, because presently right now we have two work order systems. We have ViewWorks, which we are closing out, which actually has been our tree work order system for 5 years. And we have the tree inventory, which also generates work orders. So we're trying to basically close out all the work orders that are in that particular system of ViewWorks that we're not using anymore, and recreate work orders in this system based upon some of the older work orders. So there's this huge technological bridge that I have to kind of figure out how to manage in the short term until we, the other thing too is that technological, you know, we're really, we struggle because we only have, for example, Tony doesn't have a computer, Tony doesn't have an iPad, Tony doesn't have anything. So basically everything I give the crew is all on paper. They bring it back and Terry or myself will actually create the work order or close the work order or create a work record. So she and I are both learning how to use Treekeeper. I don't think it's that difficult. And I like it. It tracks all the work history of a tree from the caller to the very end. So you start off with a caller that wants a tree removed, and at the very end the tree is removed, and there's a stump left, and after you remove the stump, you go back, and now that's created a vacant site. Mm-hmm. So you're gonna be constantly adding and deleting. So in order to keep track of everything that we're doing, it's important for us to be able to actually implement this program. What I'm afraid of, or what I don't want to happen, is I don't want this to get disrupted. So on my end, it's about communicating with the mayor's office and IT to figure out how the new work order system they're gonna have, which will be probably coming online in 6 to 8 months, which is Municity, whether or not we can migrate all this data to that system without any hiccups, or are we gonna have Treekeeper just be a standalone, separate, proprietary software for our tree inventory, so that, where, that way all the data is in one place, and it's not somewhere else. So those, go ahead.
The orders then wouldn't go into Treekeeper, or would?
That right now everything's going into Treekeeper. I don't know about what's gonna happen when Municity comes online. And okay. By then, this will be work order system number 4 that we've had to mess with in the last probably 8 years. Wow. So it's the learning curve goes along with this. So in order to keep track of everything, all the trees we've planted, all the trees removed, the pruning cycles, everything is really, this report states a lot of different things in a very short time frame. But if we can't keep track of it, it's not really, it's gonna be a real struggle. So that's one of the things that I have been working on. Of course, I got interrupted with the weather, but it's normal, it's happened. As far as, I would agree with Lily, I think that the time frame is a little ridiculous. I think 5 years to get all this work accomplished, and then, trying to finance it. You know, you're talking about $2.3 million. And really, all you have to have is one disruption and one storm and one hurricane, and it takes that whole plan and just tips it right off the scale, because that changes everything. And that's happened twice in, we had a 2011 storm, and we had a storm this year, which we had a lot of damage to trees, which basically kind of ran us right off the rails when it came to actually doing tree work. So part of the issue is trying to balance what this report is asking or suggesting that we do, and the other part of this is the request from residents. So there's two sides to this management. So we can have this all neatly packaged in a box and say this is how we're gonna manage our canopy, but yet you have the pressure of residents, which is normal and is to be expected, but it adds a dynamic to it that it gets you sidetracked. Mm-hmm. Some of the things we agree with the residents want to have done, some of the things we don't agree with. So it, you know, and there's always constant public outreach. So there's a lot of moving parts that go to implementing this plan that are not really in this plan, I think. And so, I think really for me, it's the having the actual raw data of what we actually have is just it's awesome, and it's kind of overpowering for me personally, because to actually go into Treekeeper and actually look at all this stuff and say, well, you know, I can just go find things and they're there, and it takes time and it takes a lot of effort, but I think over time we'll be able to get a lot of this accomplished. How we're going to get it accomplished is I don't know at the moment. This is why we're meeting with the mayor to determine what kind of groundwork we can lay out for the future. So I do think though that I think one of the things that sticks out that's important is the high risk removals that need to be addressed. The actual tree pruning, because there are some tree pruning and some prunes that are tree prunes that are high risk as well. And the other thing that we need to continue to do is plant trees. So even though this year this is brand new, we're digesting all this information, I think we need to continue to move forward and actually plant trees like we have in the last 2 years and actually increase that by using the recommendations, some of the recommendations they have, and then some of our own recommendations. I don't think we should stop planting. That's what I'm afraid of. I don't want to stop planting at all. Because the thing is how are we going to balance this from an operational standpoint, from actually supporting the tree planting operation to actually doing the removals and the cycle of pruning that they want. So that is really another big question, is how we're going to bridge that. And obviously, Tree Northampton potentially could help tremendously, but I don't personally think it's enough. You know, I don't think it's enough at all if we're going to try to stick to a 5-year timeline, which I think is totally not doable, unless you were to have multiple private tree companies come in here, and then I don't really know how you would manage the work. It would be impossible. You actually have to probably do like a ward. You could probably do a ward a year, maybe. But that's a lot of work, and there has to be someone on the ground with them that is a city representative constantly, all the time. So there's not too many communities that actually have tree crews. We're very fortunate we have a very good tree crew here. Mm-hmm. Larger communities have tree crews like Springfield, West Springfield. But most folks rely upon they rely upon Davy Tree, or they rely upon the utilities actually coming in and do a bunch of line clearance, and they come along and do hazard tree risk assessment, and they end up actually their hazard mitigation program, they remove trees. But we're fortunate that we have internal folks that do this for a living, and they're trained and they're very well qualified. So I think given the large task at hand, we have to figure out how to keep those full-time employees moving on that, you know, to keep actually doing the prunings and removals that we need to have, and then actually have the planting really be supported by a volunteer organization or through the DCR planting grants, however we may do it. So we have, you know, we have the two entities, they work together, but they're separate in a sense. That's the only way I can think we can manage it, because there's no way that we can do all this work, or at least part of this work, and still spend the whole summer watering trees like we did last year. You know, last year taught me a great lesson about how we had one full-time seasonal employee, and then we used two full-time employees to supplement that when we needed to water all the trees. So really, from a standpoint, it's not really a good use of full-time resources, in my opinion. So.
How much pruning has your crew done over the years, Rich? Like for maintenance, not so much emergency, but has there been much of any effort?
There's probably been, it's cyclical in a sense. So in 2011, we did a tremendous amount of pruning, but that was because it was based off emergencies. So we would go to it. Yes, it's all reactive. We would go to a tree that had broken limbs, like on Barrett Place, and we ended up saying, well, there's this tree, and so we would just stay there for a week, and we would just, you know, providing everything else that was, you know, any hangers that were anywhere else in the city, everything was down on the ground. We would just go to these individual locations and just, you know, cut broken branches off properly, and then just reevaluate the trees as we went along. The problem is that there's no I want to say live information. You know, you go into ViewWorks, and ViewWorks just really is a database that says that we were at this tree at this date, and we were there for this amount of hours, and we did this, and it says the health of the tree was that at that particular time. But you can't migrate any of that information into the system, so there's no matching it. So it's like we're almost starting from scratch.
So I would just like to affirm that it's reasonable and rational for you to be overwhelmed by this with the resources that you have on hand. But I think that it compels us all the more to create a realistic plan so that we can get in line for the resources, and whether they come from the city or DCR or volunteer organizations or a Indiegogo campaign for, you know, raising money to plant trees, that we have to bring all those to bear to actualize our plan, but we can't do any of that unless we have a realistic plan. So I feel like this is very much like step one, but I don't want us to get so overwhelmed by this to go, well, let's just kind of go back to, you know, let's just do what we've been doing, because at least, you know, we're a little bit ahead of, you know, the net loss of trees, and, you know, it's working on some level, but I feel like there are a whole lot more resources that could be brought to bear to this. We just haven't tapped them yet because we haven't made our case. And I feel like this plan gets us one step closer to making our case, but this plan is not our case. It can't be our case. You know, we'll just never, people will laugh at us. But so I feel like there are elements of this that can be our case. Like, I think the 5-year pruning cycle of 1,500 trees is, it's 5-year pruning cycle of 10,000 trees.
10,000
trees. Is just, you know, cookie talk.
Yeah.
But I feel like some reasonable, you know, pruning plan could happen. You know, it just has to be something that we feel like we could actually bring resources to bear. So, like, I want us to not think that what Rich has now at his disposal is what is going to execute anything close to a plan like this. It's just not. We have to just think bigger than that.
Was Davy Tree hoping we would hire them to do all the pruning?
I don't know. So that might be a good place for me to leave, because I feel like there's more talking we could do about this. This is just like such a baby step into this, but it's a good start. And I still want to get Todd and Jay to put their thoughts on paper. And I feel like we could put this on the agenda again next week, especially because Rich and I will have just had a conversation with the mayor. And I'm hoping that it's just a preliminary conversation. It's not like we're not going to him with our ask, because it's just way too early for that.
I spoke with him last week about this, and you know, he reminded me, as I reminded you, that the capital planning budget is closed for this fiscal year.
Yes.
And you know, I think that he's open to listening to, you know, he really would like to, you know, this is a guide.
Yeah.
So it is really a guide. The job of the commission is to decipher this guide and determine what's the best plan for our city. Because really, in a sense, this has our data in it, but in a sense, it's somewhat generic.
Well, it's somebody else's plan. I mean,
If you look at Chickadee's plan,
it's almost identical.
It's almost identical.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
With the exception of the fact that they, you know, that some of their survey was a little different, and some of the criteria was a little different. But basically, this is a plan that is like a carbon copy.
Yeah,
and
it's
cookie cutter. Your data is dumped into it.
Yeah, yeah, it's cookie cutter. So here's one thing I just want to say about that. I don't feel like we should be advertising this as like the city's tree management plan. I just want to make sure that if we roll this out to the public in any way, I want to make sure that that is not communicated. That this is now what the city of Northampton has adopted as its tree management plan. It's not. We hired a consultant firm to, you know, to do a tree inventory and to give us kind of preliminary recommendations. And that's what this is. This is, so, does that make sense? Because I just really feel uncomfortable with this plan in its current form being perceived like a member of the public reading this and going, Jesus Christ, they're gonna come to us with like a $2.7 million ask for, you know, removing 1,000 trees.
Well, I think maybe what would be good would be, you know, anywhere in here, the Public Shade Tree Commission could actually have a statement in here about this plan and about what the next steps are and what you're actually going to do with this plan. And one of those could be, we are going to actually develop a really tailored plan for Northampton, which will follow some of the data recommendations, but will also have other recommendations as adopted by the Public Shade Tree Commission, the tree warden, and the mayor's office, you know. So that way, people can say, look, here's a document with a lot of data in it, but we are going to go above and beyond what this document says. And that way, our folks won't get, they'll say, well, you know, the Public Shade Tree Commission isn't, this is not the final draft, they're not quite done, but this is just, it's just a guide.
Yeah.
Is there anything that you found missing in the report? I mean, there's a lot of things that were put in. Is there anything that might not have been included?
Missing. That's a good
one. I mean, even items that might cost, might go up.
Yeah, like if we're going to just like use this as, all right, this is useful information, and we're going to sort of, you know, take it into consideration and, you know, build our plan from it. As we're building our plan, is there anything that wasn't included that is...
I think one thing that wasn't included for me is actually how they, how the aerospace and international standards, how they figured out how much it costs.
Right, yeah, I was curious.
You know, so I mean, is it based on availability in Massachusetts, we have to learn about contractors? It costs twice as much as a regular full-time employee hourly rate for a wage. So, you know, where do they come up with those numbers?
And do those numbers include the planning time and the tracking time? Or is it just the pure in the field cutting the tree down time?
That's actually a good point.
I think that's a reasonable follow-up question to that. I really do. I feel like, you know...
For transparency, they should say, oh, this is the formula we use, the algorithm we use, for sure.
Yeah.
I mean, I think that's totally reasonable.
I am formally passing the baton.
Okay.
All right.
See you guys.
A little bit. See you next week.
Thanks, Lord.
Ciao.
Take care, Lord.
Okay, well, let's see where we are here on the agenda.
So are we closing this up? I had another question, but...
Yeah, any final questions or comments? Okay, go for it, Jen.
I just have a question. This may be for a larger discussion, but do you feel like as far as management, as far as like continue, like to be able to manage tree keeper ongoing with all your other, between you and Terry, I mean, that seems like a huge job to me. So, you know, my mind went to, you know, is it possible to have a kind of permanent intern position where we would collaborate with the city, with Stockbridge, and say, I just know from my perspective when we are always trying to have like permanent internship spots that we can say, oh man, this student, you know, this is a guaranteed spot. So there's this kind of even flow, and in order for the student to get the spot, they have to be up to date. And you could, you know, screen them, they have to be, you know, whatever year in the Stockton school or, you know, whatever, you know. It's just an idea of not to have you lose being in charge of it at all, but just kind of the nuts and bolts of, here's the paper, you know, from the tree crew, you know, put that in and did the interface work, or, you know, like they could follow up on all that stuff. Not make decisions, but more.
So one of the things that's been built in our capital budget for this coming fiscal year, FY18, is that we, Donna, the director, actually has asked for tablets for our phone.
Say again, Donna's asked for?
Tablets like this one, similar to this one,
yes.
In the field. So the goal is that hopefully Tony will eventually, once he's trained, and will have a tablet on his own.
Got it.
And so I can just send him work that needs to be done via email, and then he can accomplish it, and after he's done the end of the day, he has his information right there on the job site.
Right.
Or right at the tree,
yes.
As he's doing it.
Right. So basically what I do is I go out in the field, so I've, you know, discovered that there's a lot of trees. So and again, because Northampton has such funny roadway layouts, that there's trees that Davey didn't add to the tree inventory. And that's because they base the majority of the inventory on our assessor's maps. And the assessor's maps are, as Rob knows very well, they're a little skewed.
Oh.
And the roadway layouts are very different.
Right.
In Massachusetts, the way that we determine the city tree is that it's within or on the public right of way. So
any part of it?
Yes.
Any part of the roof layer
and trunk. So anyway, so going to the tree, I'll stand there and I'll enter the tree right there in tree keep, right, there's no hiccups. And it works. The mobile application I have works really well. It's very easy. It's very simple to work with. So you just go bing, bang, boom, and enter it. And then you can actually do your assessment and determine your work that needs to be done, and then it gets dumped into the system. And you just move on. So the goal is to actually eliminate paper.
Got it.
So.
That would be a better solution.
Yeah.
Well, it would be a better solution, but however said, we're, 6 months away from that. So for the time being, we are going to continue to manage trees the way that we did before, but the uptick in the management is actually, now that I have data on trees, they're telling me that are high-risk trees, I have the data to actually go and look at these trees. Instead of being a reactionary operation, they are now going to be turned into a proactive operation and actually go and find these trees that they identified and make our own determination based on Davey's recommendations.
Well, it'll make a huge difference to how we think about the plan and how the run we are or are not worth after you've looked at enough trees that Davey marked to get an idea of whether or not these are actually trees that need to be heavily pruned or removed. But maybe a lot of them, maybe they're just being very cautious. A lot of them, they're just saying, look, that tree looks like it might have a problem. Because they're much safer if they mark it as removed than if
they are.
Don't. I mean, they err on one side.
They are. And every certified arborist looks at a tree differently.
We should move on, you guys.
So I just want to ask, Rich, how long do you think it'll be before you might be able to get an idea, like a sample, maybe a 10% sample or something like that?
So you guys, sorry, I'm going to do it the legal
You can't answer it? You don't know?
I would say, to be
we're
honest,
we're already like 10 minutes behind the agenda.
Probably a month.
Okay.
Month and a half.
Okay. Got all that, Donna? Why do I always call you Donna? Sorry.
Promotion, that's all.
Promotion, Rob. She got a promotion, I like that.
Okay, we have 15 minutes designated for Arbor Day planning, and we've got about 6 minutes.
I don't think it'll take that long.
But just so you guys know, Molly and Lily and I talked after the last meeting and kind of crafted an initial thought process. Since then we revised it, so why don't you go ahead and give us the
revision? Well, we were initially thinking was, besides giving out whips, is doing a bicycle tour of magnificent trees, similar that was done, I guess, several years ago. We were also going to do tree planting with maybe high school students this time. So we were working along those two lines. But we basically decided not to do the bicycle tour thing because it would take a lot of planning to try to find those individual trees. And initial research that I did, I don't think there's really going to be enough trees to make it really exciting and interesting. That could be something that we look into for another year, but I think we're now focusing more on some students from the environmental club at the high school possibly being involved with tree planting. And there's going to be Lily and I and some students from that club and Britt Albritton, who's sort of a liaison with the Unitarian Society, and their youth group are going to meet on Friday and see what might happen around that kind of tree planting effort.
Yes, so in addition to doing the tree whips handout at City Hall, because last year's tree planting was so successful at the elementary schools in working with a different age group, especially in the current climate, thought that would be, we can build on that foundation. And because the time was so condensed for the magnificent tree bicycle tour, perhaps we could do that next year or fall year.
I just had an idea related that ties together the two things we were just talking about. Besides, in addition to an intern, another possibility might be maybe some of these Arbor Day activities could involve a routine inspection of the newly planted trees from last year and year before. And we could go around and take some of these students and use them to look at the individual, just even just to say if it's dead or alive. Go visit the individual trees that were planted and see in a rough kind of way how they're doing, and record that in some kind of a database. It could be an educational thing for them. And
and we couldn't actually make it fun if we found those what was it? According to the report, there were 909 trees that Davy Tree said needed urgent removal. So even if, I don't know, maybe even like create some sort of like map and make it sort of like a, sort of a treasure hunt.
Like a scavenger hunt?
Yeah.
Go to the tree.
Like these are the 25 trees, find them and let us know. I don't know.
I guess my other question is, what day are we going to do this?
Arbor Day.
Are we going to do this on Arbor Day? Because originally it was
That was it.
That weekend. That was talked about.
Right. Different day.
I think we had it down for the 7th, the 6th or 7th of
April.
What was it, April or May?
We're thinking about pushing it up to May, aren't we? The first Saturday in May.
I have it written down for Arbor Day.
The whips.
April 28th. Oh, that is actual Arbor Day. Yeah.
How long can you hold the whips? Not. I mean, the whips arrive just before.
Okay.
Yeah, the whips usually arrive.
Oh, right. They deliver it.
They deliver them via mail usually the week of week of Arbor Day, and they need to be. That week, so they're out of our hands and they're not dried out.
Oh, we were going to do the tree tour was going to be on May 7th.
But we're not doing that.
Right, we're not going to do that. So we could do this other thing. It could either be that weekend of Arbor Day, the 28th, 29th, 30th, or it could be the following weekend.
The past couple of years, we've done Friday, Saturday. I know that Saturday is the People's Climate March in D.C. I don't know if anybody's planning to go, but that had been raised before.
Oh, that's the one that's on the 29th of April, right?
Yeah.
So you could do the whip distribution in a reasonable time frame, Friday and Saturday, and then this other thing with the high school students you can do on a separate weekend.
Right.
It doesn't have to be the same weekend.
Right. Yeah. No,
you know, if people are committed to the other event, mm-hmm. You know.
But we're
limited.
Plant trees with high school students?
That was the initial idea we had, planting trees, but I just popped into my head right now that we could use those students for inspections. I don't know what would be more useful.
I think planting trees to be trees would be more useful.
Uh-huh.
I think actually maybe not doing inspections, but doing, you know, giving them a map and saying, you know, here's 25 trees, we want you to go and identify them. Based upon, you know, some kind of a fun, because tree inspection kind of involves, if they have a lot of knowledge,
uh-huh.
You know, you can say, oh, this is a big tree and it's got some broken branches.
Well, I was talking about just the young trees that were recently planted.
Oh.
Just basically dead or alive. Are they all still alive?
Well, by May, you'll be able to tell.
That's what I mean.
Hopefully they'll be.
That's what I'm saying. I mean, I don't know if that's a routine that you easily can do just on your regular routine, or if that is a time-consuming thing that would be helpful to have somebody else do.
I don't know. That's actually a good question. I mean, we do it based upon because we're watering.
Oh, okay. Well, if you're going around watering them anyway, then you don't need somebody to do it.
Well, let's hope we're not watering them that early, but we did last year.
But you will be sometime during the year.
Yes.
Even trees that were planted last year are going to be watered this year.
Yeah, they all get bags on.
Yeah, I saw the bags.
So people really do keep track of them.
Well, then the extra inspection is not necessary because you will see them when you water them. So forget that idea.
I don't know. I think for me, I know there's a lot of, planting trees on Arbor Day is just, it's tradition.
Classic.
It's classic tradition.
Yeah.
They've done it since the 1800s.
Yeah.
And it's involved a lot of.
I think we should stick with that.
I think we should stick with that.
Yeah.
Now, like our theme that we did last year.
Yeah.
And if we're able to plant trees on Arbor Day, or maybe the following weekend as well with students. But I think the significance of planting and actually having Arbor Day events on Arbor Day or near Arbor Day is pretty significant.
All right. So why don't we plan on that Friday, the 28th, Molly? Because Molly and I are going to co-chair. Lily found that as the chair of the commission, she did a lot of the chairing the Arbor Day Committee, so Molly and I agreed to co-chair. So that Friday, Saturday, we can plan on, do plantings on the Friday.
Friday.
With students, the 28th of April, and then also some tree planting at City Hall that Saturday morning. Like, I think last year we did 9 to 12.
I thought we said Saturday is the People's Climate March.
Well, not everybody on the commission actually was involved with both the planting and the handing out of the whips.
Oh.
And the whips are hand out on Saturday. I think we did.
For 2 days, right?
We did 9 to 12 on a Saturday.
Right.
So it'll all happen on the Friday and the Saturday. The high school students will be available on Friday.
The role that Lily's playing is just contacting the high schools and the, I guess, supervisors of the clubs, so.
We'll find out more on Friday, because we're gonna meet with them then, so we'll find out, you know, first of all, would it work better to do it on a school day or on a weekend day? And, you know, is this Friday the one where everybody's taking the SATs and, you know, going crazy, or is that a, right, yeah, right. You know, we'll pick a date, probably by this Friday, I would think.
But at least the tree whip distribution, we could do the Friday, Saturday, is that one tree whip?
And last year we also had some people help, like Tree Northampton Font, so some of our volunteers, it wasn't Tree Northampton at that time, but some, we had volunteers help hand out the whips that weren't us.
Uh-huh, yes. Great segue.
So that's another resource for, you know what I mean? Yep. Tree Northampton could populate the table.
Okay, great segue. So now, Rob, it's your time to do the Tree Northampton.
Well, Tree Northampton actually wanted to come and have their little bit of literature at the table at the same time. Actually, they didn't exist last time.
So. No, they didn't.
Okay, so they want to be able to have some cards, be there, and help hand out. That, if that works for everybody, that won't happen. So you can figure that at least one or two Tree Northampton people being available, probably the whole two mornings that it is until one. What time?
We did it from 8:30 to 12.
Yeah, so both
on Saturday morning, and then on we did 9 to, I think we did like 9 to 2.
Oh.
No, we did 9 to 2 because the operational thing is staff has to break everything down and take it all back. So we did 9 to 2 on Friday.
So
we did 8:30 to 2.
So Tree Northampton will probably have a couple of people there. One or two, depending on what you want, during that period, those periods. That would be a help.
Yeah, they reached out and said that they were interested in helping. Do you want to give your update on Tree Northampton, Rob? Anything else going on with them?
What is going on? I haven't really thought about it. I mean, they're very busy.
Their pruning workshop.
They've been trying to organize a pruning workshop, which didn't work out.
Is there a date set for that again? A new date?
I think there is a new date that hasn't been sent out to everybody. Rich knows the date. It's the 20th. It's the 25th of Saturday?
I think it's the 25th.
So Saturday.
February.
February.
Yeah, Saturday the 25th will be the next. It fits in very well with our.
Oh, yeah, I've got it.
With our tree management plan. And it looks like really we're going to hope for volunteers to do a lot.
Where do we meet for that?
There'll be at least 20 emails when people decide where it'll be, but it looks like it'll be good. And so they're doing that. I've actually started going out and doing setback sightings, which is something that I just want to mention, that the Tree Northampton, anyone who wants a tree that's on their property can go out.
That would be a good thing to put on the Arbor Day.
Yes.
Handing out the trees.
Well, that's why we like to go, because then you meet people and talk about, do you want a tree? And I just want to mention all this discussion with the tree management plan, all Rich's responsibilities, entering stuff into the tree data. None of that discussion is included in setback trees, which is okay. We think that Tree Northampton will be able to gather the data in a way that it can eventually be entered into a GIS program or something. We're hoping that we can at least hold on to it if people want to figure it out. I think it's really important because Tree Northampton has been working on diversity a lot, tree diversity, and trying to make sure the setback plans are highly diverse in terms of the population mentioned in the management plan. And so it's interesting if a lot, it's a way of getting diversity, but it's not necessarily going to get entered into the plan. So that's a,
right.
That's a,
right.
Something to scratch one's head about a little bit. You know, it adds another layer that no one needs more layers right now. Let's see, what else are we doing? I know that in the very near future, there's going to be some what we call tabling, where people are going to go out and try and promote trees at tables. I think that the they were looking at the Vogue School at the during the Saturday morning market, and thinking about whether they can be downtown at some point. So they're getting ready to go out, put a little table out, and promote. Basically, the setback plan was Arbor Day. They were actually going to go hand out something about Arbor Day to get people interested. So that's all I can think of. Although it seems like a lot more.
They have any upcoming meetings, Rob? I haven't heard. Do they have any upcoming?
We haven't had any meetings just lately. We have switched to the last meeting. There has been a meeting since. You heard about it. It's been Saturday, Sunday morning. I don't know if that's a possibility for you.
It all depends on the timing. I work Friday and Tuesday, so.
So Sunday morning is a possible, so.
It depends. My schedule varies every week to week. Sometimes I'm available on Sunday mornings and sometimes I'm not.
Okay, so we'll see.
But I've suggested to them if they can establish like a regular meeting time, it's just easier to plan for.
Okay, when would you like it to be?
Well, Wednesdays, Thursdays are my days off.
So Wednesday and Thursday?
They don't have to organize it around me, but I haven't yet gotten to a meeting.
Yeah, I know. It's bad.
Every time I reach out and ask, when do you meet, it's sort of like, well,
right.
I don't know when you're available, and I've suggested like a regular meeting time, and it's just easier.
But what if the regular meeting time weren't Wednesday or Thursday? What if we're Sunday morning? How would that be?
I would get there if I was available then.
Okay, probably be Sunday morning.
Just with the understanding that it could work, but
regular
is not
better.
Always there. All right, anything else with Tree Northampton, Rob?
No.
Okay. Anybody else have any Tree Northampton questions? Okay. All right, now for the recap, I didn't really capture anything other than if anybody has any further comments on the management plan, we can dump them into the spreadsheet. And then Rich and Lily are meeting with the mayor March 1st before our next meeting. And Molly and I will continue working on the.
And I'm meeting, and I and Lily are meeting.
Oh yeah,
on Friday with the.
With the
students.
Board. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
You're meeting Friday with
Molly.
Students
Friday.
From the high school.
Oh.
About Arbor Day. Would you like to be part of it? I mean, in terms of, I don't know. I mean, if we're doing tree planting, I don't know. You need at some point.
I would say organize it first, then
figure out logistics of how to actually do the tree planting.
Maybe you can ask the labor to figure out the labor basically. Right.
How many people we
what
have?
What the workforce is going to be so we can
figure
out the tree planting plan.
Yes, okay.
I think last year we, I don't want to say overextended ourselves, but I think we're right on the cusp of it. You know, I think two trees per school was a little much.
Yeah, that was with little kids.
Yeah, and it was hard to keep their attention all the time. And we also had a little issues in the background with, we got everything up with our buy-in and support staff operationally. Because we did the whip giveaway, we planted a tree in front of City Hall, and then we planted six trees at different times throughout the city.
Oh.
So, I mean, it was a very busy day and we got it all done, but it was a little.
Yeah. So two different days might actually be.
Two different days, and of course.
Whips and then maybe.
Right. They wouldn't necessarily have to be around Arbor Day. It could just be near them.
Right.
Earth Day is the week before that.
Right. Yeah.
Exactly.
Is
there anything around?
Oh, wait. Yeah.
Is there anything with the whips that you need help with, Rich?
No, I'm actually. I will actually. I got the order yet from the Mass Tree Board's forest services, I can bring that to the next meeting.
Oh, okay.
And actually, what I may do is I may actually scan it and email it to all of you.
Oh, great.
So you can look at it.
Yeah.
The sooner we order, the better off we are, especially if there's a, a lot of species that are taken, which have happened in the past. But they're pretty available. You can order all the way to the almost April 1st.
I remember the lilacs go first, but they're not shade trees, so we might want to rethink that.
People love flowers.
Yes, they do.
And Jen, did you have anything with the, you and Jay were going to meet regarding the species list?
Because of the tree management plan, and then I got really sick, and so I needed some clarity, so I think I got the clarity, and we'll do round two. And my spring semester is like ridiculous, so I just, I need a little time.
Yeah.
So I'm on it.
Okay.
But yeah, my intentions are there.
Yes. All right, anything else?
I'm a little behind the eight ball right now.
In terms of to-dos or anything?
No, that's it.
I won't be here at the next meeting. I'll be in Denver at a climate reality training in Albany. So I'll see you the third week in March.
Awesome.
All right, anybody move to adjourn the meeting?
I do.
Second.
Somebody has to jump in.
All in favor?
Aye.
Meeting adjourned.
All right.